Hello, you multi melodic minor scales. Thank you to Jamie McGregor for that malt mention, introducing Whiskey Review 484, which you will reassuringly know is business as usual. Here in the Manx Bothy, I'm Ralphie, I'm reviewing whiskies. I'm about to review a bourbon, which is a whiskey, because any spirit made from grains is a whiskey. And here it is. It's called Rocktown Arkansas Young Bourbon Whiskey. It's bottled at 46% and it looks really quite juicy. And I've been drinking it for about, well, I opened the bottle 2 weeks ago. I had a wee tiny taste, at which point I put the lid on, gave it a shake, sat it down, said I'll come back to this in a couple of days' time. Let it settle down, let the air in to open it up. And I thought to myself, well, the first taste, ignore it. We won't even try and analyse anything at all, because this is different. This is a different range and set of flavours. And when you encounter whiskies which is giving an unusual experience that you're maybe not familiar with, we need to give our senses of smell and taste time to acclimatise to the new experience. So it's advisable not to rush in with first impression judgments. And that's what I've avoided doing. 2 weeks ago, when I opened the bottle, had a quick taste, put it back in the shelf. 3 days later, I opened it again, poured a larger glass and let it lie out on the table for an hour or so, stuck my nose in it, went away, did a little job, came back, stuck my nose in again, then I had a taste, and then at that point I started to get familiar with what I was actually smelling and tasting. So although we assess things separately in terms of smell and taste, when we're experiencing a whiskey, we're usually smelling and tasting simultaneously, because that allows our senses to cross-reference with each other and to say, well, it smells like it tastes, or it tastes different from what you're smelling. And this is how we build up our experience. So I've tasted this about 8 times. Yep, fair enough. And I find it fascinating. I've got to start at the beginning, right? And it starts with an email to Rocktown Distillery in Little Rock, Arkansas. And my email says, "Dear Rocktown Distillery, have you ever, are you, or will you ever, even if there's a remote possibility, be owned by Diageo? Seeing as how I've got to check these facts out so that I don't look like a tube on YouTube." I didn't really say that, but I have emailed the distillery, by the way, because they're stating in the label, you see, that aged under 4 years in American oak, handcrafted, distilled and bottled in Little Rock, Arkansas. Now, being an American spirit, you see, my terrible suspicious mind says, oh my goodness, do they have a Rocktown distillery, but the distilling at another distillery somewhere else in Little Rock, Arkansas? That's just the sign of the times, malt mates. But here is the reply I got, because if you want to find out information about any spirit, one of the best things to do is go straight to the distillery and email them direct. My question was, do you distill at Rocktown Distillery? The reply, yes. All our whiskies are milled, mashed, fermented, distilled, aged, bottled and packaged at Rocktown Distillery, 6th Street, Little Rock, Arkansas. So there you have it. The evidence and the proof. That's all I need. I don't have to bother going into any elaborate searches and Sherlock Holmesing. So thanks to Phil at the distillery. And just to let you know, Phil, if you're watching, this review should bring a smile to your face. Here we go. Smell. Immediately complex. Natural, complex distillate. This bourbon, incidentally, is made up mainly of corn, but also contains wheat. So the nose I'm getting is quite grainy and cereal. The corn, incidentally, you do notice it's corn, but it's not that simple custard corn that you get from many of the mainstream brands. This is a corn which behaves, reminds me a little bit, It reminds me a little bit of blue corn from Balcones Distillery. It seems as if it's a less sophisticated, high-yield variety of corn. And it just simply is imparting more complexity and range of flavour through the still into the new make spirit. And in fact, I must commend Rocktown Distillery because they do source, because they say in this little label here, and I shall quote for complete accuracy. Here we are. We take pride in the fact that our corn and wheat comes from Arkansas farmers, so it's sourced in state. Our bourbon is 82% corn, 9% wheat, and 9% malted barley, and ages in small new charred oak barrels for a rich and complex flavour. Now note the word small casks, because what I'm noticing for what is advertised as a young bourbon, which is aged for under 4 years, you're really getting quite a cask involvement in harmony with the spirit. It doesn't dominate the spirit, but it makes itself known, particularly in light toasted and vanilla notes. Bearing in mind, the smaller the cask, the quicker it works in maturation. Simple as that. It's to do with surface to volume ratios. There's a mild spice. There's a lovely, delicate vegetal almond note. Mild pineapple. That rich, creamy cereal with a certain amount of camphor. Do you know, as a corn, predominantly corn whiskey, oops-a-daisy, kicking my bottles, as a predominantly corn whiskey, which is only 9% barley and 9% rye, so 18% other grains, I'm really noticing that fullness of flavour which encapsulates some of the finer corn features that we don't normally get in mainstream spirits. That camphor note, that vegetal note, that slight aromatic quality which I've encountered in Stranahan's. And importantly, it's very full flavoured on the nose for smelling, but at the same time, although it's intense, there's a softness and a clarity that you get from well-made, slow-distilled spirits. How about the flavour? So a big, almost a sort of baker's Armagnac, fresh-baked bread, brioche, Armagnac character going on. Taste. Now this gets interesting. Dry, bittersweet, sweet and sour, hint of salt, cola, pineapple, corn, grain. Reminds me a little bit of Greenore from Ireland, which is an Irish grain whiskey. It tends to kind of arrive quite measured, doesn't hang about, although it's full flavour, doesn't hang about too long, and then a nice swift but clean, refreshing, tangy finish. But then we add water and everything changes. It's like you've literally lifted the lid off a box. Can you imagine an old-fashioned record player and it's got the lid down, the record's playing, but the sound speaker is inside the record player, so you can hear the music, but it's only when you open it up that you really get the full blast of what's playing. And this is what's happening here with a spirit. It's absolutely fascinating too, because I don't generally come across this in bourbons. The nose quietens, but for the palate, my goodness, it expands considerably. Much fuller, spicier, tangy, sweet and sour, clean, slightly phenolic, camphorish, eucalyptus, even a eucalyptus note in there, certainly wintergreen. And then the development, a sustained development, rich in cereal, honey, vanilla, almond again, that nuttiness coming through, certain amount of marzipan in there. And then to the finish, you're getting, it's almost like a delicate spiced tea note. Wonderful, soft, delicate tannins, which you only get, that sort of influence of the cask, you only get from well-made casks using very good quality wood. This is very impressive stuff indeed. I've done my homework. That's what happens when you make mistakes in these. Oh my goodness. I like to think, considering all the videos that I've done as reviews online, that you could literally, you could count my mistakes in one hand. Fingers crossed. But I'm definitely doing a little bit more homework as regards my American spirits, and the result of which, I've discovered this, available at a perfectly good price from London. So that hence it's available for me to buy in the UK and of course in Europe. And importantly, this is a distillery that's not come in to the European market having got medals and accolades in the United States and then automatically trebled the price just to aspire to collectability and all to manufacture demand. There's a longer game getting played here, a much more professional sensibility at play here, and I must commend Rock Town Distillery for having that attitude. As far as it stands, with me, a whiskey reviewer, a Scotch whiskey reviewer, I'll be coming back to Rocktown sometime in the near future. Really, really enjoying this enormously, to the extent that, bear in mind, this is a young bourbon. And I sat this in a glass next to a series of aged bourbons, single cask, 10-year-old, Pappy Van Winkle bourbons. You know, not the new stuff that's being produced and, in my opinion, will probably be completely tub-thumpingly overpriced. I'm speculating there, I have to add. But really, for a young, fresh spirit, 91 out of 100, and that is a bourbon mark. Seriously impressed with the quality of this youngster. It doesn't have that component of age in it. It's too young for that. But what it lacks, it more than makes up for in the intrinsic quality of how it's been produced. And I'd conclude by saying that one of the features that I've found in this bourbon, which I haven't found even in Pappy Van Winkle, is that when I taste it and swallow and then examine the afterglow of the experience, it's beautifully fresh and sustained, and you don't get a little flash burn. Now, what I mean by flash burn is in quite a number of bourbons, in particular, it's the style of the corn, you see, in my opinion, and in how it works in pot stills, mainly, is you can get quite a bit of heat after burn. Not particularly pleasant, but tolerable. But you really notice it when it's not there. It's not there in Rocktown bourbon. And the reason it's not there is because it is quite self-evident that this has been very professionally and sensitively produced. There we go. Enough said. I love the internet, by the way. Yes, I do. As always, we should cross-reference our facts. When you see a statement online, you don't automatically take it for granted. And I tripped up recently, as you Ralphie regulars will have observed, when I described an independent bourbon distillery as being owned by Diageo. But it was my own fault because I do not cross-reference enough online. And there's so much information and it's so easily available. The skill is, the trick is, asking the right question in the right direction. That's what it is. And one of the questions I asked recently was, what does a cloud weigh? It's one of these moments when you're sipping a whiskey and you're thinking, la-di-da-di-da. Righty-o, we've done the kind of intense nosing and tasting. We can relax now, chill out, kick our slippers off and put our feet up and just enjoy the experience without asking questions, examining it or interrogating it. What's in the glass? Let's just chill and enjoy it. Right, what would I like to know? I would like to know, what's the next generation of rocket fuel, or what's the next Triumph motorbike going to be, or is the new electric Harley Davidson selling well in the United States of America? All these sort of kind of curiosity questions that we like to ask. And I thought to myself, you know, I've been a member of the Cloud Appreciation Society for a few years. I remember I joined back in 2007, something you've learned about me that you've never known before because I've never mentioned it before. But I love clouds. I really do enjoy clouds. People go to galleries and see art hanging up in the wall and all the rest of it. I think there's far more just to be lying in a field somewhere or on the sand on a sunny day in the beach, just looking at the sky, at the sheer enormity of it and what's beyond. And, of course, the reason the sky is blue, of course, is because the atmosphere is made up principally of oxygen, nitrogen and carbon dioxide. And when you compress these gases to their liquid form, carbon dioxide and nitrogen are clear, but oxygen becomes vivid blue. And it's all the oxygen in our atmosphere which is responsible for the blue sky. And in turn, the blue sea. There you are. I bet you didn't know that. And furthermore, if there was more oxygen in our atmosphere, our sky will get more intensely blue. And if there's less oxygen and more carbon dioxide in our atmosphere, then the sky will become lighter blue. But there, you know, what does a cloud weigh? What? I know it's kind of water. It's a kind of big, fluffy cushion of water droplets. That's what it is. And of course we know that water actually weighs quite heavy. That's why we've got to watch when we're bringing spirits home in our suitcases from a holiday that we don't overweigh our case. Do you know that a little light fluffy cloud in the sky weighs 3 tons? Incredible. Absolutely astounding. A standard routine columbaris cloud, that's the kind of deeper cloud, can weigh 10 tons or more. 10 tons. And if it's a storm cloud, it can weigh hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of tons in weight. So next time a hurricane, tornado, typhoon, or whatever is heading your way, one of the reasons that it's a good idea to take cover is that we don't tend to think about it, but it is probably one of a cloud, a fully laden storm cloud, is one of the most movable, heaviest things on our planet, if you don't count the sea. Anyway, I tell you what, I've enjoyed this moment, quality moment, and we've shared it. Wonderful. Thank you for joining me. I hope you've enjoyed this as much as I have enjoyed presenting it to you. And I hope that if, particularly if in the US, and you want to support your local producers, remember to go online. Go onto line, because this is a craft distillery, a proper craft distillery. And that's one reason why I'm mentioning it. Rocktown, proper craft distillery. But watch out for the crafty distilleries. Yes, these are the distilleries or the big multinationals who make their bottle look all crafty with its nice crafty, crafty label and its crafty, crafty shape and its crafty, crafty stopper. And it's all kind of homespun and retro and all the rest of it and really kind of trendy. And in fact, what they're selling you is the illusion that it is a genuine craft product. But in fact, they have bought from the big producers. They are bottling it as an independent bottling. And they are not being completely forthright with you. And because that is unlikely to change any year soon, I recommend that to be an empowered and articulate customer, go online, and if you have any doubts whatsoever, email that distillery direct and ask them, do you distill at your distillery? Do you bottle at your distillery? Do you mature what you produce at your distillery premises? And see what answer you get back. For small, genuine craft producers, I highly recommend that you state on the label that you don't just make at your distillery, specifically your distillery. Let people know everything that you do at your distillery. Just as I've had in this email reply from Phil at, where's my, because I'll repeat it again because I think it's important in relation to where we are at with bourbon at this moment in time. In fact, I don't know if you're aware, but there's other countries now starting to produce bourbon. We're not seeing it yet, but it's out there. Non-American bourbon. Wonder if you saw that coming. Yes. All our whiskies are milled, mashed, fermented, distilled, aged, bottled and packaged at Rocktown Distillery, Little Rock, Arkansas. Thank you, Rocktown Distillery. We appreciate that.